Okay, so now I would like, let me see, that looks about right. So I think there's 63 of you, and we should all turn around and look at you, because you are the only Maui dolphin left on the whole planet. Then I would like 30 of you to sit down. Roughly. And then I would like, I have to get this right. So those 30 are mostly males that have sat down. I forgot to say that, so we might have to rearrange. So it's going to be the males that sit. Look at this, it's the males that are still standing. What does that say? You're going to go extinct really soon. So we actually need the males to sit down, except for one or two of you. Because really, the females don't actually need a lot of you. One or two or do. We've got enough now. So we should have round about 30 females. And some of you are looking like you're too young to breed. So you should sit down. Some of you are looking a little bit too old. And maybe you've bred already. And had too many children even. No. So by the end of it, we should have about 15 standing up. And everybody should look, because these are the 15 people, or Maui dolphin females, that are going to keep this population going. And you're all going to have to live for 20 years. Only one of you can afford to get caught up in a set net, or a trawl net, or get toxoplasmosis, or eat too much plastic, or just die of old age. And so, the rest of us are guardians. We're going to keep you going. So stand up, everybody who's already signed the pledge. Oh, there's some tardy ones among you. Stand up, everybody who's going to sign the pledge. Okay, give yourselves a clap. So, that's why we need as many people as possible to sign the pledge. And we've really got, New Zealand, we're blessed with some of the most amazing species on the planet. We have the smallest dolphin in the world, the Maui dolphin. We have a third of the world's seabirds breed on our shores. We have wonderful yellow-eyed penguins. And we have sea lions and we have whales. But every year, thousands of seals and sea lions and seabirds get caught up in our fisheries. And really, we don't want to be killing our Hector's dolphins when we're eating our fish and chips. We don't want to be killing our albatross when we're eating our ling, and we don't want to be killing our yellow-eyed penguins when we're eating our flatfish or our fish and chips. So we really need to change how we think about fishing. It's not okay to be killing these protected species. And it's not okay that even that we should manage our fisheries so that we tolerate the accidental deaths, because the accidental deaths amount to thousands of deaths, and they're contributing to the decline of our species. So the way we're managing our fisheries is not working. And luckily, when I look out there, to borrow a phrase from this morning, I see a sea of people who are prepared to bring about change. And I see a whole rough sea of white caps. They're going to put that fishing industry under pressure and bring it into the 21st century, as our wonderful minister said. It's not only our animals and our wildlife, it's also the trawling that Megan wants to ban, thank you, which is great, because they're trawling up these wonderful old corals, particularly out in the seamounts, and these corals can grow really, really, really slowly by about a millimetre a year, and they're thousands of years old. They're our giant kauri forests. And we wouldn't want to cut down a kauri forest or a kauri tree just to have a meal of fish and chips. So it's no longer acceptable that we tolerate this kind of bycatch. with our yellow-eyed penguins. When I first moved to Dunedin more than 30 years ago, I can remember snorkeling out at Sandfly Bay and appearing, just landing on the beach, putting my head up just above the water and seeing, being surrounded by yellow-eyed penguins. Now when we go to Sandfly Bay, we meet tourists who say, we've been to Courier Bay, we've been to the Catlins, we've been all over the place and we haven't seen a yellow-eyed penguin. Because you can see that graph, that population is just being decimated. Some of that is to do with disease, and some of that is to do with the fishing industry. Just in the last year, we're in 2016 because we don't have the most recent data, there were 13 observed penguin captures, and of those, three of those were yellow-eyed penguins. Two of them were Fiordland Cresteds, and the rest were Little Blues. And they've been caught in the rig and the set net industry or in the butterfish industry in Fovo Strait. So we've talked about Maui and we've talked about how there's only 63 left. Hector's dolphins down my neck of the woods, they're doing okay out in Banks Peninsula where there's a sanctuary, but they're not doing okay around the rest of the South Island. And they're in discrete small populations. So I was just talking to Heather before and she says, I think you've got six in Golden Bay, Heather, is that right? And so in Otago, we've got a population around about 40, and Liz will correct me if I'm wrong. And in Courier Bay, we've got a population of about 20, and then there's some in Tawaiwai Bay as well. So those discrete populations are incredibly vulnerable. And so we need to be protecting every one of those animals within those populations, or else we'll end up with local extinctions. And just in the last year, between August and April of this year, we know that there were 8 Hector's dolphins caught in trawl nets, mostly off the Waitaki River and up in Pegasus Bay. Sea lions. Sea lions have recently been upgraded, I suppose, with their threat status, and you might think that the sea lion population is doing quite well. Part of the reason why it might have been upgraded was because there's a new population that has started down in Pegasus on Stewart Island, and which is because the sea lions are spreading from the Auckland Islands and they are making a bit of a comeback on the mainland. But in the Auckland Islands, that population hasn't changed, and there was the pop estimates were actually lower than last year. And so we know that sea lions also get caught in the squid fishery, and we know that at least 6 have been caught this year. Sharks. Over the last 5 years, about 2,700 mammals have been caught in bycatch, including humpback whales, 2 elephant seals, 3 leopard seals, and 6 Hector's dolphins, and more than 2,000 fur seals. With the basking shark, which is the picture on the bottom there, they used to see, what do you call them, squadrons of basking sharks, when you would see 40 or so together off the coast of Canterbury. Now they're very rarely seen, and people don't understand quite why they've gone missing. So the bycatch rates haven't really changed. You can see with the orange line there that it really, since 2002, it has gone up and down and fluctuated and is rising. And this is for the longline industry. This is where they do actually have some mitigations and there are some rules. But New Zealand doesn't have the best in the world rules. We don't demand a 3 out of 3 mitigations, which is setting at night, having tory lines and having weighted hooks. We allow them to have weighted hooks and tory lines, but actually set during the day. So we don't practice best in the world at all, and yet we want other countries to do better. So we don't have regulations, and most of what happens out at sea is, as Fred Dagg said, is beyond the environment. We really don't know what's happening. So the fishing industry likes to say, but we're doing all this mitigation, and some of them are. Some of them are doing as much as they possibly can. And in some fisheries, like in the set net fishery, there really aren't any mitigations that are going to work. But despite everything that they've done, it hasn't actually changed the rate at which bycatch in seabirds is occurring. The number of seabirds might have declined in the last few years that have been caught in our fishing industry, but that's because fishing efforts declined. It's not because they've actually got better at avoiding bycatch. So some of our worst fisheries are the surface longline for southern bluefin tuna, where they catch the albatross and our petrels, and the bottom line fishery for ling, which also catch the albatross and the petrels and our sort of shearwaters. And of course the deep water trawl for squid, hoki, scampi and waraha, where they also catch albatross as well as seals and sea lions. And the inshore trawl fishery, which catches the black petrel up in Northland, and of course up in Hauraki Gulf, and of course the dolphins and the yellow-eyed penguins. So the observer coverage is pretty much appalling. For most of our, the average over our entire fishery is about 12% at any one time. Some fisheries hardly have any. So you can see with the inshore set net there, about 97% of that industry has no observers at all. And yet they are the ones that are killing our dolphins and are killing our yellow-eyed penguins. The inshore bottom line, pretty bad as well, hardly any. The only one that had a reasonable amount of observer coverage was the squid industry down in the sub-Antarctics. So one of the things that we're really wanting is that we need 100% observer coverage, whether that be by humans or preferably by cameras on boats. And unfortunately, this government has done a lot of progress on a lot of things, but it's really failing us in not rolling out the cameras on boats. And the set net industry is really bad. In fact, this was data from last year where 95% of the set net industry went unobserved. This year it's actually 97% went unobserved. So we've got even less observer coverage. So we know what's happening because now we've got some really brilliant tracking data that has been able to model the overlap between the fishing and where some of our birds go in particular. And so these are yellow-eyed, this is modelling for yellow-eyed penguins based out of Banks Peninsula and in Oamaru. And so Thomas Matton has been able to work out what is the favoured penguin habitat. And so that's mostly the habitat that's marked in the dark red and the orange, which is sand less than 70 metres deep. That's where most of the penguins are foraging. And all those white triangles represent set net fishing effort. So look at this density here, and you've got penguin colonies all around these bays here that are going up in this direction, all being exposed to fisheries here. Then you've got all around Fovo Strait and around Codfish Island, where you've got the yellow-eyed penguins being exposed to the fishing industry there. So we know there's this massive overlap between the set net industry, the trawling industry, and fisheries, and yellow-eyed penguins. And with the Antipodean albatross, and Graham's not here, but these are his slides because it's Graham Elliott and Kath. Not only do they look after snails and mohua, but they also look after albatross in the Auckland Islands. These Antipodean albatross only breed in the Antipodes and on Auckland Island. And these two, they take a long time to court and then they mate for life. But there's been a massive decline in both the Antipodean and the Gibson's albatross. Since about 2006, there was a big population crash where both populations declined by about 50%. And the Gibson's albatross is starting to improve, but the Antipodean albatross is just going down and down and down. And one of the reasons that Graham and Kath thinks might be happening, and Graham and Kalinka, who also work on it, is that the females of, there's now two males for one female. So as we saw with the Maui dolphin, that's completely the wrong way around. We actually need a whole lot more females. And what's happening is that the females are now having to move further and further away in search of food, possibly in relation to climate change. And so they're getting caught up in the fishing industry, in the deep, and the red marks the intensity of the fishing industry. So where those blue circles are happening is where our albatross are getting caught up in the fishing industry. So luckily, Minister Sage was on Codfish Island when Dr. Graham Elliott was also on Codfish Island, and as you do, you have a word in the Minister's ear. And this has partly led to New Zealand government, and it was actually Winston Peters signed the agreement with the Chilean government that they are going to start to do something about the Antipodean albatross. But it's not just in international waters, it's also in New Zealand waters that we are killing our albatross. Sea lions, it's a whole similar issue. The rate at which sea lions have been caught, even though they've developed some new fisheries techniques with the sled, which supposedly lets the sea lions escape from a trawl net, and we don't know how many die doing that because they're deep divers and we don't understand whether the sleds are actually working. But the rate for which the sea lions are caught in the squid fishery, it goes up and down a bit. But it hasn't really had a steady decline. And part of that is because you've got the females from Enderby Island. These all overlap with where the intense squid fishery is. And then you have another population from Dundas Island, and they overlap a little bit with the squid fishery, but most of the overlap happens here, and that's where 75% of the fishing interactions happen. So what would a zero bycatch look like for New Zealand? So we really need to avoid those places where seabirds and sea lions and our dolphins live and forage and hang out. So we need area closures. And then we really need to focus just on safe modern methods. So we might look at phasing out set nets, because set nets are an indiscriminate form of fishing. We'd look at phasing out trawling, and then we would need to really, really adopt absolutely world's best practice mitigation techniques, and we'd need to have a government department that is really focused on 100% observer coverage and enforcing those rules. And all these things are possible, and this year we've got our biggest chance ever to get there, because we've got the National Plan of Action on Seabirds is coming up, and that will be coming out in July. So we'll be asking for zero bycatch for our seabirds to be the goal for that, and having targets and performance measures to actually achieve that. And then we've got the Hectors and Maui threat management plan is out now, and those submissions are due on the 8th of August. And then we're going to have a national plan of action on sharks. So we've got three big opportunities to get zero bycatch into some key policies that are driving how our fisheries are managed. And we need to get those cameras on boats. So with Maui dolphin, we've heard how extremely rare and threatened they are, and we've got to get it right in this management plan that's out now. So once you've all signed the pledge, and you've got thousands of other people to sign the pledge, in about 2 weeks we'll be launching our campaign to help drive getting lots of submissions for the threat management plan. And the threat management plan applies to Hectors and to Maui. And while the management plan does do some good things, as Minister Sage pointed out, it doesn't stop trawling and set netting out to the 100 metre depth zone, which is what we really need for the Hectors and for Maui dolphin. And for Hectors, you can see that they do a little bit of extra protection up here and a little bit of extra protection here and down here, but all of this area down here, there's no extra protection for Hectors and none down the west coast either. So unfortunately, while there's lots of things that are good about the threat management plan, it's going to need a lot of submissions as well. And that's what we really want the recommendations to look like. So it goes out to the red, goes out to the 100 metre depth, and that would protect the Hectors and the Maui. and the green needs to be a bit further. And of course, for the Maui. And people used to go surfing with Maui's dolphins, but that's just, and that wasn't that long ago. So within our lifetime, that population has just become decimated. So we need everybody to support Zero Bycatch, and you've heard Minister Sage this morning and her colleagues, some of who were a bit stronger than others. And we've got Minister Nash, and he's quite keen on trying to bring the fisheries industry into the 21st century as well. And we've got some of the fishing industry leaders are also saying that really Zero Bycatch has to be their ultimate aim. So people are starting to say the right thing, but we actually need them to do the right thing. So that's really why we've launched our Zero Bycatch campaign. So what we would hope you will do, and down here we've got a Christmas present for each branch, because we need thousands more to sign up onto the pledge, and for you to go back to your branches and start spreading the word. And you've all done lots of campaigning before, you know how to campaign, holding sign-up events, because we've got some sign-up forms, pledge forms. You don't all have to do it online, although it's easier and better if you can do it online. And we've got posters, and we've got some flyers to hand out, writing letters to the newspaper, because the ministers need us to be the strong voice for nature, because we need to give them the social license to drive this change, because the fishing industry is opposing it left, right and centre. So we really, really need the public to stand up. Visiting your MPs is really important, and of course writing submissions, and Forest and Bird will be having our usual submissions templates and helping guide what should be in people's submissions. And we know we can do it. Some of you might recognise Forest and Bird in the old days. And we've, as Minister Sage said, we've achieved many of our goals on land, but out at sea it's still really beyond the environment. And it's still a bit like the wild frontier, and that operates largely unseen. So our Zero Bycatch pledge is, we hope that that will be the catalyst to drive the transformative change that's needed in our industry. So if everybody who represents a branch, and one of the things that we'd really like is within each branch, if there was somebody who would like to become a marine champion. Because as you can see, we've got quite a lot of marine things happening, and we're going to have SEMPA, the Southeast Marine Protected Areas, coming out soon. And we really would love to have a marine champion in every branch. And we'd love it if somebody from each branch came and collected one of your Christmas presents. So, thank you.
One or two questions?
Yep.
Thank you very much, Sue. We will do a couple of questions if anyone has anything burning that they would like to ask Sue. Otherwise, I will leave it for you to grab one of these packs after we finish up. One down here, if we can. Oh, okay. We'll go over there and over there. Sorry, in the middle.
Hello, Irene. Is that on? I'm Irene Thomas from the Kapiti Mana branch. I'm just interested in that graph you put on, the Sea Lord Bycatch graph. Apart from some spikes on the surface long line, it seemed like the other two lines hadn't changed since 2003. How many birds are actually caught in fishing? Because it said, it looked, I don't know what those numbers meant on that graph. I wondered if you could look at
that. That graph was actually to show you that the rate, it wasn't actually about numbers. Because that's what's important. It's actually, because you need to be able to compare apples with oranges. So it's the rate. So it's the number of birds or animals, in that particular slide, it's the number of birds that are caught per tow or per hook or per metre of set net.
Okay, well, it looked like the number hadn't changed since
2003. No, and that's what's so disappointing, because, and that's what, we just don't have the mitigations for some of those fishing techniques. We're going to have to be inventive and adopt new technology, particularly for trawling and particularly for set netting. We just need to get rid of set netting.
I'm not sure what the graph meant. Thank you.
Cool, and just one over here.
Kia ora, Sue. This morning, Tina and Aura sort of highlighted the dangers of National League campaigns and how they weren't always necessarily the most effective for Papu to engage in, and how many iwi preferred like localised solutions, and how national campaigns weren't like conducive to that, like Zero Bycatch, for example. How can, like, do you think Forest and Bird can adapt our campaigns in a way that's going to be to act like good treaty partners and best like engage with Iwi and Hapu in the way they want us to engage, if that's not national campaigns?
Thank you. Yes, it's a good, because a lot of these species are taonga species as well. And sometimes maybe it's possible at a local level to focus on a particular species that might be particularly threatened through the fishing industry. Like, it's easy for us in Otago because we've got hectares and we've got sea lions and we've got albatross, but pretty much all around the country there'll be some particular species that each branch might be able to focus on to use as their kind of icon for change. And of course, I mean, you've all got different ways of doing things in your local communities as well. We've just tried to provide some posters and things to make it a bit easier for you to go out and do it at a local, regional level. But I know you'll do it in Dunedin.
Cool, thank you very much. We might leave it there.